This hour is brought to you by Sweetland Waste and Removal Service, a homegrown company serving Southern Indiana since 1995.
We're coming to your city. Gonna play our guitars and sing you a country song. We'll all be flying higher than a jet airliner. And if you want a little bang in your yin yang, come along.
Well, come on along and welcome aboard to Indiana Sports Beat Radio. Coming to you here on this Monday, October 7th from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios. Hope your weekend was good and, ready to get your week off to a good start. If not, we're going to get ahead in that direction for you. On the program today, the great voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fisher's on the program. Look forward to talking to Don. Football's back this Saturday. Had Hoosier Hysteria to talk about over the weekend. Mike Schumann's going to be on as well. We'll talk about that with him. We'll hear from Calbert Chaney, Race Thompson, Jerome Hunter of the IU basketball program. Lots to get to and talk about. Yeah, football was off over the weekend with a bye week, getting healed up as they head into Rutgers on Saturday, which should be a tune-up, basically, giving the Hoosiers their fourth win of the season, which would put them two wins shy of bowl eligibility. I think they're going to be bowl eligible with three games to go. How's that? Rutgers is a team that is in a tailspin. I mean, I'm not laughing at them. It's just that's all you can do at that situation. They fired their coach, their offensive coordinator. They're not that good. This is going to be – you talk about rest. Indiana having a bye and then having Rutgers after that. It's just going to be like having a nice rest for 3 weeks. Another week of getting some really good practice in. That's why this team is going to be good. They're going to continue to improve. I think that they can go to Maryland and Nebraska and come back with wins. How about that? Back-to-back road wins in the Big Ten. I'm going to have to look up how long it's been since that happened. Because that has to have been a hot minute. Matter of fact, that's a good I'm going to look that up. Back-to-back road wins in the Big Ten in football. Feel free to do so if you're listening. We got a lot of people that get on that stuff quicker than I do. Tim's already texted into the show. Saw a picture of Leo Galloway Lander on the back of a golf cart all wearing the candy stripe. Looked like they were having fun. Would love to see all three on the floor at the same time in 2021. Yeah, you and a lot of other people, Tim. You're going to get two-thirds of that for sure already committed. Christian Lander, the linchpin of that class. I'll tell you who was not there. I took a picture of and posted over behind the bench of Leo Lander, Galloway, Trey Kaufman, and Caleb First was in attendance. But I'll tell you who was not, Dawson Garcia. Take from that what you will, but they were not able to get him in. And other than Christian Lander, they weren't really able to get anybody in that big-time recruit that they're chasing. So this is kind of a weird year. I'm not sure how much more effort they're putting into recruiting this season because they had the targets that they needed and wanted, and while not getting those targets – I guess it's best to just go ahead and push it off until next year, although they have an available scholarship right now that I guess they can carry forward to next year, which is a gigantic class. The 2021 class in the state of Indiana is pretty big. You got people like Christian Lander, Trey Kaufman, Caleb First, all Indiana kids that are all pretty daggone good. I mean, Christian Lander, obviously a point guard. Trey Kaufman, a bigger dude, 6'7". He'll probably grow to 6'8". Caleb First, same. He's got size. If you're continuously getting the best in the state of Indiana, you just need to add a little. You got to sprinkle a little bit of elite around that from someplace else, and voila, you've got a basketball program, folks. Indiana's lived on that for years and years and years. You don't have to go outside the Midwest to get the to get what you need. And they'll be back to that. I mean, after that 2021 class, this roster is going to be chock full of Indiana kids. But you still need that elite talent. Either for that talent to become elite or to come in that fashion. The Christian Lander is one of those guys that, looks to be elite as it is. He'll certainly get the opportunity. The men's basketball team on the floor, you got to see Jerome Hunter, which had to make a ton of Hoosier fans happy. I'm not sure, you know, I just talked to Archie in Chicago at the Big Ten Media Days about Jerome Hunter. I asked him specifically, you know, how much realistically can you expect from him? And he said he had tempered expectations. I don't know how much he'll be able to go. It's going to take him a while to get into the game shape. But from what we saw, he moved well. He looked good. Trace Jackson Davis is going to be so good next year. I'm not saying he's not going to be helpful this year. He will be. But next year, this dude's going to be tough. He's got the skills, man. He's got the skills, the size, the want-to, the ability. He's going to be a leader on that team. He is going to be, you can tell, he's going to be someone who grows into a leadership role sooner rather than later. He has that in front of him to learn from right now, but he's going to be a good one, an absolute good one. These are the kind of teams being put together that Indiana needs. Now, it's taken too long to get to this point, I think. I know this is only the third year, but I think that the recruiting was kind of jacked around a little bit in the beginning in efforts of trying to land people that they just couldn't land. But I think the roster is heading towards where it needs to. They need to roster balance is one of those things because it's going to be kind of rocky. But the talent coming in, you can't complain. We talked to both Race Thompson and Jerome Hunter Saturday after Hoosier Hysteria. Jake, you got Race Thompson? Let's hear what Race has to say.
Race, I know this is not a real game, but getting out there in front of the fans, game-like conditions for you especially, coming back off an injury, what was it like out there for you?
I mean, I got a little taste last year at the end of the season, so it wasn't really nothing I wasn't expecting. It's just playing basketball is what we do. I mean, it's what we're good at, so it is what it is.
Probably more than 10,000 fans here. How do you feel overall about the support and the fact that you can have an event like this and have so many people?
I mean, we got the best fans in college basketball, so it's no surprise, really. It's a lot of fun, and they show a lot of love, and we appreciate them a lot.
How the first week of practice goes, the team, and kind of what are you looking forward to here as kind of you get into the preseason?
First week of practice was really, really good. I think we took steps forward every single day. So, I mean, this year, I mean, I think we got big things ahead of us. So, I mean, the sky's the limit for us.
What do you feel your role is going to be on this team?
I'm not sure what my role is going to be, but I'm going to do whatever it takes to win games. You guys saw it last year, I do whatever it takes. It's not about points. It's not about the fame. It's not about any of that stuff. So, whatever it takes to win games.
I think Archie's referred to as a Big Ten banger. How much do you kind of emphasize or take pride in the physical nature of your game?
I mean, I'm just playing my game, so... I do what it takes. If I don't have to play physical, I won't. But, I mean, it's part of Big Ten basketball is playing physical, so it's all good. All right.
One of the strengths is it for you, team? For a guy like Justin, to be able to guard a little bit more versatile? You got guys like Deron, Joey, Trace that can kind of really protect the basket, but you and Justin, guys that maybe can guard a couple, three different kinds of positions. Kind of
what, what was the first part of the question?
Just how important is it going to be for you and Justin specifically to be a little bit more versatile defensively?
I mean, it's real important. I mean, being able to be a versatile defender is an important thing in the Big Ten because you got all types of players. So, I mean, being able to guard the five, the four, and even people who guard in the three. So, I mean, it's just important overall, I think.
The front court looks like it's going to be a strength.
But It's fun. I mean, we compete every single day. But I mean, only making us better. So it's just a lot of fun playing against those guys every day.
What did you learn about yourself when you were going through a lot of hardship last year, the injury, coming back to prepare for this season? What were you able to do even though you were hurt, and how did you get better?
I learned a lot about myself. I'm strong. I mean, I had to keep my mind in it. I was out for 2 months, so really just keeping my mind in it and just staying with it every single day, rehabbing, just going like to therapy and stuff like that. It was tough, but I mean, I did it, and I just really learned a lot about myself then.
How important do you think it's going to be for you to knock down shots from the perimeter and handle the ball a little bit?
I mean, Coach emphasized that a lot. We shoot every day, twice a day. So, I mean, Coach tells me it's important for me to be able to knock down shots. So, it's real important.
I'm sure Hysteria is a perfect time for all of the fans to meet the new guys. You've been playing with them for months now. What do you know about the new faces, especially Calvert Cheney Jr. there?
I mean, you got Trace, Armand, Nate, Joey, Cooper. I mean, all those guys, they help out in practice a lot. I mean, everybody's working super hard. We don't got a lot of bodies, as you see, but everybody's putting in their work and everybody's doing real good. I mean, Calvert Cheney's great. He's a great player, great, all-time great.
You know about Cheney?
I know a little bit about him. I'm from Minnesota, so I mean, sure. I know a little bit, but I know he's an all-time great, so it was fun to meet him today.
Yeah.
All right, Trace, thank you.
That was Race Thompson. You heard the questions about Cheney at the end. During the dunk contest, Trey Saxon Davis, after he won the contest, he wanted one more dunk and donned a Calvert Cheney jersey to do so. So that was pretty cool. But it was pretty cool to see Trey Saxon win the dunk contest. Cool to see Calvert Cheney there as well. He did speak to us afterwards as well. He talked on stage as also. He had got his dance on. It was one of the posts that I put on Twitter. You can follow me on Twitter at Jim Coyle ISB. But I posted that on Twitter, Calvert getting his dance on. He was loose, man, introduced by Archie Miller. They had a stage set up. If you weren't there, they had a stage set up on one end of the assembly hall floor. The goal was gone and a stage set up, literally with a big video board, kind of like a rock concert in essence. Everybody was coming out of the doorway and Archie came out once introduced and brought out Calvert Cheney, but he was loose dancing, but really throwing his full support behind Archie Miller. And Archie is working hard with those past players to keep those relationships because he knows how crucial it is to keeping the fan base behind him. Because when you don't win, things get rough. And let's be honest, they haven't won yet. And they're not predicted to win this year. I'm not saying that that's going to be the case, but so to have that support of those former players is huge for Archie Miller and people like Calvert Cheney and Todd Leary, who's on this program, throwing their support behind Coach Miller. It's could not be something that Coach Miller relished anymore. I'm certain of that, but Calvert Cheney did speak to the media afterwards. Let's hear what Calvert had to say.
Here's Calvert on the stage. First off, we'll get to that one first.
Again, I just like to thank everyone. I'd like to thank Archie. I'd like to thank everyone who was responsible for the tribute video. Thank you very much. I'm 100% behind Archie and what he's doing with this basketball program, and I hope you are too. I really look forward to this team and how they develop this season. And I hope you are too. And come out, support this team, no matter what. Like I said, this is a developmental team. This could be a special team like Archie talked about. It's going to be about development this year and trying to do the best they possibly can and put the best possible team on the floor. And I'm looking forward to that. Are you too? I hope you are too. Again, thanks a lot. Let's have a good time. Let's go Hoosiers. Go Hoosiers.
One more. There was Calvert talking on stage at Hoosier Hysteria, but he spoke with the media immediately afterwards.
Calvert, you just go and talk about what it means to be inducted in the College Basketball Hall of Fame, and we'll start from there.
I tell you what, it's a tremendous honor to be inducted into the College Basketball Hall of Fame, to be inducted with the likes of, you know, Shane Battier, Larry Johnson, Lute Olson, Rick Majerus. I mean, that's a very high esteemed class, and I'm just lucky to be a part of it, happy to be a part of it.
What was it like for you to be back and be a part of so much value? You know, the fantasy camp, you're part of that, you're back here at Perusian Estero. You've been back a lot, right?
Yeah, like I said, I'm just like showing support for the program. Like I said, it never gets old. I mean, I love, you know, I've been removed from being a basketball until the graduation for 25, 26 years. So, but I always want to come back because the program is very, very important to me, and I just want to help out any way I can.
You said you were behind Archie, what he's doing in terms of how he's building the program. What about the program that you see from the outside?
Well, I just think, like I said, in terms of development, it's given an opportunity. Like I said, I mean, he's his third year in, and hopefully, like I said, I think he'll get some things done. It's just a matter of him developing the kids, getting the kids he wants, and then we can go from there. And then, but I think he's done a good job at this point. So hopefully this season will be an indicator of that.
What do you like that you've seen so far?
Just the way he's a great defensive minded coach, really does a good job defensively. And I think he's done a great job recruiting kids within the state, but at the same time, I mean, he does a great job recruiting in general. And so hopefully, like I said, within the next year or two, hopefully we can see some things. But like I said, I'm anxious for this year. I'm not just for him to do it. I'm anxious to see how the team turns out. But the key thing with me is, like, you know, I'm a big developmental guy, developing kids, and I think he's done a good job of doing it.
When you talk about development, you've been on coaching staff at this level, what are some of the most important things?
Oh, just getting better in your all-around game. Like I said, there's no secret formula to getting better except for old-fashioned hard work at it. And that on top of, you know, obviously, the game has changed. Changed over the years, but the objective stays the same in terms of, like, you got to get out there and you got to work on your game. And I think we've got some guys out there that really want to get better. And at the same time, not only as individuals, but as a team. And, we all know the team and chemistry. Team chemistry is huge at any level of basketball. So if we can get that going, I think that everything's going to be in good shape. I mean, I'm really excited to see what they can do this season.
Calbert Janey, after Hoosier Hysteria, talking to the media, he wasn't the greatest, but it was tough conditions for us there. But we got to listen to Calbert, got to hear from Race Thompson before that. Got a little bit of Jerome. We're going to have Jerome Hunter for you tomorrow, but just to give you a little taste of what that was, let's hear from Jerome.
What did it feel like actually getting out there in front of the fans and actually playing kind of a real game?
I mean, it felt good. I mean, I couldn't wait. I mean, the whole year off, I've just been thinking about how I was going to be when I went out there. And I love the fans here. I just love how they act when you get a buck. I mean, when you score. And, I mean, I just love the atmosphere.
There was Jerome Hunter for you. We'll have more of him tomorrow. I also got to speak with him extensively after Hoosier Hysteria. We've got a lot more coming up here on the program, none bigger than the voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fisher. He's going to join me next right here on Indiana Sports Beat Radio from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios. Back with Don right after this.
Oh, the storm and its furies rage today. Crushing hope that we cherish so deep.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the golf club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
This is AJ Moyer.
This is Dan Dockett.
Hey, this is Michael Lewis, former Indiana basketball player.
This is Indiana football coach Tom Allen.
This is Jim Coyle with the Indiana Sports Beat. You can always like and follow us on Facebook. Always follow the show rebroadcast on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spotify. TheDailyHoosier.com is a great place to sign up for each and every day. Or, of course, on 97.7 The Ref in Evansville. For the best recycling and waste removal service, turn to the area's leader, Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling, a homegrown company serving southern Indiana since 1995. Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling serves Floyd, Clark, Harrison, and Washington counties for excellent service and peace of mind. Call Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling today at 812-944-5642. That's 812-944-5642. Keep life sweet with Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling.
I'm Rain Shaddy, and I'm a Hoosier. As a toddler, you could always find me running around in a cream and crimson onesie and a red IU hat reminiscent of those worn during the world-famous William Tell timeout, shouting, "Go Hoosiers!" Like many other alum, I chose to make Bloomington my home. As a civic and alumni leader, I have become very knowledgeable about our community and would love to share my insights with you as your realtor. Find me on Facebook or call or text me, Ryan Shaddy, with FC Tucker Bloomington Realtors at 765-623-9093.
You're on the line with Jamal Meeks, former Indiana Hoosier, number 23, 1992. And I'm on the beat with Jim Coyle.
Today's guest is brought to you by Reynolds Family Dentistry of Sellersburg. You need a million-dollar smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you'll get with Reynolds Family Dentistry. Welcome back, Indiana Sports Beat Radio, of course, coming to you from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios here on this Monday, October 7th, and we can't think of a better way to start the week off than with the voice of the Hoosiers, Don Fisher. Don, how are you, sir?
I'm well, Jim. How are you?
Good, good. Can't complain. A weekend off from IU football. Kind of missed it, Art. Didn't take long to start missing it, but had some basketball in between to tie us over. Hoosier hysteria took place. So a little bit of taste of Indiana basketball, and a great audience turned out for that.
Yeah, it was a nice crowd that was on hand. A lot of kids, a lot of parents, and obviously some students, but more. I think more of the general public was there than there was student body that was there. Interesting from my standpoint, because usually the student body shows up in mass. I don't know if we saw that. There may have been a lot more students than I anticipated, but I just didn't see it, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, exactly. It's a great chance for a lot of people who don't get the opportunity a lot of times to get out to Assembly Hall, that don't have season tickets or whatnot, to bring their kids out. And saw tons of that. A lot of autographs going on afterwards. A great fan interaction. So a great opportunity for fans that probably, like I said, don't get a great opportunity to see the Hoosiers.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, you didn't get to see everybody because you had three players that didn't participate because of minor injuries and that kind of thing. So all we know is at this juncture is this is a basketball team that showcased Jerome Hunter for the first time outside of Hoosier hysteria a year ago. And this kid, just I think he's going to be special if he can stay healthy. He's one of those guys that, to me, has the it factor, if you know what I mean.
Oh, absolutely.
I just like what I see out of this guy. He wants to score the basketball, and I think he's very capable of doing it. I thought we saw an Al Durham that had, again, looked like a guy that could really knock down threes and maybe can do it under tough situations. I liked Al's performance in the three-point shooting contest. He was a winner in that regard. Was it with Allie Patberg, I think? No, it was Penn.
Jalen Penn?
Yeah, Jalen Penn. He and Jalen Penn were the winners of the three-point shootout. There's obviously, I think, Trace Jackson Davis, a true freshman, is going to be special. Very talented kid. I think he's one of those guys that's just going to get better and better as the season progresses. I like Armon Franklin a lot. I think he's a true freshman that is going to be, you know, one of those 3 or 4 year players that really can help your team. He's kind of a glue guy. And I also think he's very talented too. I think there's a lot about this team that is to like. The question mark is, can they get everybody healthy? And Deron Davis sat out the scrimmage, as did Devontae Green, who suffered an injury, I guess, during the week last week in practice. I don't know how long he'll be out. But, again, none of these injuries look to be long-term. Hopefully everybody gets back and is practicing sometime this week.
Yeah, it's just an opportunity just to get a first look for a lot of the fans, and it was great to see Jerome Hunter on the floor, like you said. I remember watching him in high school at Southport over there for a tournament, and just he's a very talented kid, and you hate to see anybody have to sit out because of injury. And to sit out an entire year, you know he is just chomping at the bit to get back out there, and you see why. He's such a talented kid, and he brings a lot to Archie Miller's team, too, and I know Archie would like to see him out there desperately.
Absolutely. No question about that. Deron Davis didn't play in this game either in the scrimmage on Saturday. He's been held out because of a low leg injury. It's minor, I guess, based on what everybody tells me. All I know is at this juncture, they've got to get guys healthy because this is kind of how we started last year, if you remember. And injuries always play a big role, especially if you sit out the very important practice sessions at the beginning of fall practice. A basketball team at this juncture is working on fundamentals and really important things about getting the offense and the defense set up the way you want them to. I do think that this team has a lot of versatility to it, a big front line or bigger front line than Indiana's had over recent years. I think that'll help. I don't think there's any doubt that Joey Brunk, a transfer from Butler, will help this team. I'm not going to sit here and tell you that he's going to be a superstar. I think he's a glue guy. I think he's one of those guys that brings some leadership. He's experienced the big-time college basketball atmosphere, so he's already used to those kinds of things, and I think he really wanted to be at Indiana. I think that's the big story there, and I'm looking forward to seeing him participate and see what kind of help he can give this basketball program. I think Archie believes this team's got a chance to be good, a chance to be really good and better than people anticipate good. So hopefully all those things come to fruition. But, again, we're just getting started.
Yep, if they can hit shots, they'll be pretty good because they do, like you said, they have a pretty good front line there with all those guys. But we'll look forward to basketball getting started. And before we get to Indiana football, how about that win by the Colts last night over Kansas City? That was huge.
Well, it was, especially after the disappointment last week of the Oakland Raiders knocking them off. But then Oakland wins this past weekend as well again. So Oakland may be better than people think, but the story last night was a tremendous performance by the Colts. The defense played much, much better this week than they did a week ago, and the offense, Jacoby Brissett, I thought, did a really nice job in this ball game, made some big plays, and the Colts just did what they needed to do. And the defense, like I said, I thought the defense played terrific because they put pressure on Patrick Mahomes all night long, and of course, he was dinged up a little bit. They've got their injury issues as well. And the Colts didn't play with Darius Leonard. He was on the bench again with that concussion protocol that he's dealing with. So it was a fun game to watch, though. It was really good, and I love the way the Colts hung on to win it.
Yeah, the defense, man. When you shut down a guy like Patrick Mahomes, who's possibly the hottest quarterback in the NFL right now, you're getting something done. And just a remarkable comeback from, like you said, the week before, a huge disappointing loss. But then Oakland's looking good. Life's looking good for the Gruden family, except for old brother who just got fired from Washington. So NFL's a strange, strange place to live.
Yeah, well, if you're a coach in the NFL, you've been hired to be fired.
Exactly.
There aren't very many guys that survive. Yeah, there aren't many guys that survive in that league very long. The ones who do are the great ones, of course, and everybody else just seems to kind of come and go and, of course, gets rehired someplace else to try again. That's the good news for the coaches there.
Yep, there's always a job waiting for you. Well, speaking of football, we're back to football action for the Hoosiers this week as they're back in action at noon on Saturday hosting Rutgers. Had a nice break for them to get healed up, basically, get everybody back together. And a perfect time. I mean, they didn't get the win up in East Lansing, but a great performance. And you can see there are great things coming for this team and this offense.
Well, Michael Penix was just sensational 2 weeks ago against Michigan State, or a week and a half ago against Michigan State. I mean, to sit out 2 weeks and practice limited time and the week leading up to that ball game, it was a pretty impressive performance, to say the least. And he was lights out. a gunslinger in that ball game. Did exactly the kinds of things that you knew he's capable of doing. Really got the team rolling offensively. The offensive line, which obviously is missing Coy Kronk now for the rest of the season, got a step up. Not a step up from Coy, but at least got a solid performance from a true freshman by the name of Matthew Bedford at that left tackle position. I think he played virtually every snap at the left tackle spot in that ball game. I think they were worried that he probably would wear down in that contest, but he played the entire game. And I guess held up fairly well in the contest against a very, very good Michigan State defensive group. So that was a plus. They didn't run the ball all that effectively, but with Penix's arm, sometimes you don't really need to do that. And I thought Kalen DeBoer's offensive game plan was absolutely sensational. I think this guy is really special as the offensive coordinator in this football program, and I'm really excited that Indiana's got him. That said, the defense, again, did not play up to my expectations. I have all season long thought that this defense had a chance to really be one of the special defenses that Tom Allen has had, and they continue to give up big plays at the end of halves and at the end of ball games that get you beat. And that's been an ongoing problem, not just for just this staff and this team, but for teams at Indiana since Bill Mallory was fired back in 1996. I mean, this has been an ongoing issue, to finish games against quality opponents and to be able to pull out a victory. And this team didn't do it again against Michigan State. That's the disappointment from that outcome. And until that changes, until they do beat somebody, there's always going to be that feeling that this is the same old Indiana. And I don't like to say that. I don't like to think about it. But that's the impression that is given by your performance. And honestly, I don't know how to get over that hump, so to speak. At least at this point, it looks like this Indiana football team has got a chance to do that talent-wise, but the defense hasn't played up to their potential, in my opinion, at this point. And that's what's disappointing to this point in the season.
Yeah, you put 31 points on Michigan State in East Lansing. You're normally going to expect to win that game. The offense, that you can't ask a lot more of an offense, especially an offensive line that had, like you said, freshman Matthew Bedford, who was outstanding coming off the sideline, limited play in his career, and steps in to a place like East Lansing and plays the entire game. It was remarkable. But defensively, they've got to make these plays. And you talked about that. The deal with not finishing, it's almost a cultural thing for the program, and you don't want to think that, but they've got to get that mindset to where they are capable of winning every game no matter what.
Absolutely. And I do want to say I thought there was a real bright spot on the defensive side of the football in that contest, and it was Tywan Mullen, another true freshman. Who came in this ball game and just absolutely, when he was on Daryl Stewart couldn't do anything. Unfortunately, he wasn't on Daryl Stewart the entire ball game, especially in those tight situations down at the end. They were able to isolate Stewart away from Tywan Mullen, but I think that kid played tremendous. I mean, that was one of the best freshman performances I've ever seen by a cornerback. If you understand what I'm saying here, this guy did a phenomenal job of covering one of the best receivers, not only in the Big Ten, but he's one of the best receivers in the country. I just thought he was spectacular and probably may have won himself a starting role for this ball club.
Yeah, Tywan is someone that they knew was special, but I don't think any of us had an understanding of how special. When you're a true freshman, and you come into the Big Ten and to make an appearance like he has, it's pretty mind-boggling. But I remember talking to him way before the season opened up, and one of the great quotes that I got from him was that, "I didn't drive, come 16 hours away for nothing to not do something special here." And he means it. He's just such an easygoing kid when you talk to him. Very, very humble. But my gosh, what a performer he is and is going to be. This kid's going to be spectacular defensively for Indiana.
Well, if he plays like that, he won't be around for 4 years. Because that was his performance in that game was mind-boggling in my mind just because of of what he was able to do against a veteran receiver like that, who was much bigger than he was, and just handled it. I mean, he just handled it. Hopefully, that wasn't an anomaly, because I do think this kid's really good, and they've talked about him. The coaching staff has talked about him for some time. That was really the first chance we've seen had a chance to see him perform to the level of which they've been talking about, and he certainly did. He came through in that vein, and I think that spells good things for the rest of the defensive backfield.
Absolutely. You're back in the booth this week on Saturday at noon for the game. I'm sure you're ready to get back to it.
Absolutely. Rutgers, it's homecoming week, of course, and Rutgers is the opponent, a ball club that's really struggling right now. They're 1-4. Fired their coach a week and a half ago. They're playing with a head coach that's now on the interim basis, their tight ends coach, who was only been in the college profession for 2 years. He was a very successful high school football coach back in New Jersey. But they're a team right now that's in trouble because they've got their starting quarterback. They replaced him with another kid named Johnny Langdon. And their starting quarterback is one of those guys that is upset about that. So he is contemplating the transfer portal, as is Rasheem Blackshear, who's one of their best running backs. He's already decided that he's in the NCAA transfer portal. So they've got guys leaving. They've got all kinds of problems there. Indiana should have, I would think, little or no trouble with Rutgers on Saturday.
It certainly should be a fun time. Hope the weather is great. Look forward to having Don Fisher and Buck Sewer back up in the booth calling the games for us.
Yep, we'll look forward to it. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you. Have a great day. We'll be talking to you again next week. Don Fisher, the voice of the Hoosiers. We're back with more Indiana Sports Beat from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios right after this.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the Golf Club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
This is A.J. Moyer.
This is Dan Dockett.
Hey, this is Michael Lewis, former Indiana basketball player.
This is Indiana football coach Tom Allen.
This is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat. You can always like and follow us on Facebook. Always follow the show rebroadcast on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spotify. TheDailyHoosier.com is a great place to sign up for each and every day. Or, of course, on 97.7 The Ref in Evansville. For the best recycling and waste removal service, turn to the area's leader, Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling, a homegrown company serving southern Indiana since 1995. Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling serves Floyd, Clark, Harrison, and Washington counties for excellent service and peace of mind. Call Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling today at 812-944-5642. That's 812-944-5642. Keep life sweet with Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling.
I'm Rain Shaddy, and I'm a Hoosier. As a toddler, you could always find me running around in a cream and crimson onesie and a red IU hat reminiscent of those worn during the world-famous William Tell timeout, shouting, "Go Hoosiers!" Like many other alum, I chose to make Bloomington my home. As a civic and alumni leader, I have become very knowledgeable about our community and would love to share my insights with you as your realtor. Find me on Facebook or call or text me, Ryan Shaddy, with FC Tucker Bloomington Realtors at 765-623-9093.
This is James Wagner Jr., former Indiana Hoosier. Make sure you're keeping up with the Hoosiers on Indiana Sports Beat.
Today's guest is brought to you by Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, with hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer. Pizza, burgers, beer. Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Because the desert had turned to Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beat Radio here on this Monday, October 7th. And welcome in the horse with no name himself, Mike Schumann from the Daily Hoosier. How are you, Mike?
Pretty good. I don't know what to do with that intro, but I'm doing great. How are you, Jeff?
I like to keep them on their toes, man. I got to keep people on their toes, brother. Big weekend. Hoosier hysteria got underway. No football. Indiana was off for the bye week. But had a little Hoosier hysteria. A pretty good crowd showed up. I talked to Don Fisher earlier. He was on the program, and we talked about the crowd. He said that he thought it looked like it was less students and more non-students, which I'm assuming was just a lot more people who normally don't get the chance to go to an Indiana game. I saw tons of kids taking advantage of the autograph sessions and all that stuff. But a really good crowd. I mean, the lower bowl part of the arena was filled except for the corners.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I was a little bit surprised with how many people showed up. I mean, you go back to last year and all the kind of the hype and excitement going into that season with Langford and Morgan and everyone expecting a big year. And I think there were more last year, but I don't think it was significantly more, maybe a couple thousand people more. But and I agree with what Don said. I mean, I went up and down the stairs a few times reluctantly. And when I did, I didn't see students really at all. I saw, you know, who I saw is the same people that I saw, you know, not literally but figuratively, that were there during the NIT games last year. You know, just as you're saying, that the folks that may not get a chance to always go to things at Assembly Hall, but when it's a, you know, a free opportunity or an opportunity where season tickets aren't involved, there's people that take advantage of that. And it was all in all a pretty good showing from the crowd.
Yeah, but it also goes to show you, can you imagine if the Indiana basketball program was rolling, if they were doing what they used to do, how insane these crowds would be, how nuts the following would be? Because look at it, when they're not, when they've missed a tournament 3 out of 4 years, and it's still Indiana basketball.
Yeah, there's always that advantage there of just a lot of built-in hope and optimism and a fan base that's really never going to give up on this thing, especially the little bit older generation crowd like you and me that have seen the good days and know that what's possible and know how much fun it is when things are going right. I think those people are always going to give it a fair shot. And you're right, if things were actually, you know, rolling right now, which they could be down the road, then you're going to have a lot more students and a lot more younger energy in the building as well.
Saw a couple guys in attendance there. Of course, Trey Galloway and Anthony Leal were there. They've already committed to the Hoosiers, but a couple of guys that Indiana is chasing would love to have. First and foremost, Christian Lander was in attendance. We had a text in from Tim earlier about the picture. I saw the picture that they were riding on the back of a golf cart in the candy stripes, I guess, doing some pictures and whatnot before. But also Trey Kaufman from Silver Creek down in southern Indiana was there. And Caleb First, I thought, I saw him as well.
Yeah, all those guys were there. I shook a couple of their hands and told Trey and Anthony congratulations for their commitment to Indiana. I understand there's going to be some good pictures coming out here at some point of all those guys. You know, at least the guys on official visits, Galway, Leal, and Lander, you know, more pictures in the candy stripes. I think there's a whole photo shoot that went on like often does. So people should be out on the lookout for those. And I'm trying to connect with Lander this week to get a debrief on the visit itself. But by all accounts, what I've heard so far is it went really well. I think those guys, Christian Lander and Leal and Galway, are close. You know, they were teammates last year on AAU, on Indiana Elite. Lander played up a year with those guys, and they've built a good relationship. So I think it's, you know, Indiana is in as good a place as you could want them to be for Lander, but the big caveat there is he's a five-star. By most accounts, he's the top point guard in the country for incoming juniors. So it's not going to be, you know, just because he's a kid down in Evansville that likes IU and has friends on the team, it's not going to be that easy, because we've all seen what happens when the, you know, the Kentuckys or the Dukes of the world start calling.
Yeah, I think the thing for Indiana, they have to win. They have to show that they can win this season. They have to show that this is a program that Christian Lander wants to come be a part of. I know the fans don't get it. They want to hear this. Well, we want the guys that want to be here. What the hell does that mean? Who goes someplace they don't want to be? I've never understood that, but that's the fans' mentality. But here's the thing. You've got to give them something to come to besides a reputation that's 25 years old. So they've got to see that this is a viable program that is capable of winning in the tournament. And they haven't done that yet, and hopefully that changes this year. But that's a fact. I mean, you're not going to pass up on Duke or Kansas or wherever when they're doing those things, if that's what you want to do, because a lot of those guys don't think that their college experience is going to be that long.
Yeah, and playing in the NCAA tournament, getting on a good run in the postseason is a great way to create more publicity for yourself. We've seen plenty of guys do that through the years. I mean, that I don't know how important winning is, but it's definitely important. These guys definitely don't want to play in the NIT every year. And so I do think that Indiana is going to have to prove something to recruits that this is a place you can go and win and be seen and get publicity. So I think it's a big part of it. I think you're undeniably right. And I think the other big part of it for Lander is something that I remember his dad said on your show a month or two ago about, you know, it's just got to be the right fit. It's got to be the right situation. When you look at a roster, I mean, every team's going to have a point guard or two on their roster, you know, for him to consider. But, you know, how stacked is Indiana going to be at that position at this time next year? You know, do they take a 2020 point guard that he has to consider? Or is it just going to be Rob Tennessee on the roster, which, you know, would be a senior when Lander would be a freshman? So not a whole lot to give you pause there. So I think it's a combination of a few things.
And here's the thing. The list that I listed, all the guys that were in attendance, Galloway, Leo, Kaufman, Lander, and First, all Indiana guys, which is great. You want that. But the one problem, there was no one there from Indiana, which, again, continues to be an issue recruiting-wise of being able to land kids that are not from Indiana. And I don't really count Geronimo, because that's a kid we thought he was going to play Division III. So he leapt at the chance when you dangled a scholarship. He's like, oh, hell yeah. So he was all in. So it just shows that still having an issue getting these elite kids from outside the state of Indiana.
Yeah, and I would even take it a step further, is that they also had no incoming seniors there other than the two guys that are already committed in the class. Now, of course, part of that's because you already got three guys verbally committed. So how heavily are you pushing or emphasizing the senior class? But that's a little bit unusual. I'd have to go back and check and see when the last time that was the case where they had no one. I mean, last year it was the seniors were the highlight with Trace Jackson Davis and Keon Brooks. So, you know, I think it's partly just the nature of the class that they already have, but you know, you think about guys like Dawson Garcia, who people were saying had other commitments, but, you know, Hassan Diarra, who was just there, you know, I think, you know, part of it could be that their primary targets, you know, just it just wasn't the right weekend for them. But that was unusual. You know, the out-of-state thing, it continues to be important. I guess the only thing I'd say about it is that, you know, with such a stacked 2021 class and with, you know, Archie and this staff doing so well in state, you know, I think that they feel like they probably don't need to go out of state that much, especially in 2021. I mean, they're as it stands right now, they only have three openings in that class. You know, you saw, I think, three of the guys that they're probably at the top of the board in that class there on Saturday night, with Lander first and Kaufman. Then you also have a guy like Blake Wesley, who I think Indiana's really going to start pushing on. I spoke to his dad, you know, 6-8 weeks ago, and you know, I think that's a very real opportunity there for IU to make a push on. And then you got a guy like Luke Goody up in Fort Wayne. I think between Goody and Wesley, you know, I think those are two guys that could round out that class. They're not going to get all those guys, but I think, you know, that they're not going to have to go out of state in 2021. So it's important. I think you can't rely solely on Indiana every year, but that could be part of the reason.
No, they don't. They're, like I said, if you get the best of Indiana each year, you're going to be fine. You still need to sprinkle in here and there, and I think that's what's missing, that sprinkle, that little extra right. something. Because if you look at this team coming up this season, there's not a star on this team. And a lot of people are going to go, that's great, that's how it should be. No, it's not. You need to have – what team does not have a star, really? Look at Virginia last year. Kyle Guy was a star. He may not have started out that way, but he sure ended up that way. And I think that that's just – there's something missing. I hope that's not the case. Maybe that the teamwork can overcome all of that stuff and much better chemistry. But, yeah, there's no doubt that there's a lack of star power on that team.
Yeah, there is. And, I mean, obviously that they had it last year. I guess if you go back to Archie's year one, I don't know that going – Yeah, going into his first year, I don't know that they really had a clear star. Obviously, Juwan Morgan became that guy, but he wasn't expected to do what he did going into the season. So I don't read too much into, you know, are they better because they don't have stars or better if they do. But what I would emphasize more that is that, hey, this is year three with Archie. This is quickly becoming his guys, his roster. You know, he's still got some holdovers from the Crean era, but for the most part, you know, you're talking about a third year in his system with his culture. You know, the identity of this team should by now be starting to take on the flavor that he's trying to implement. And, you know, I think we're past the days where you start talking about, you know, these aren't his guys. This, you know, this isn't what he's trying to build. You know, there's still some holdovers, but I think by all means, this is the year that, you know, whatever happens from a results perspective, this should have all the markings of an Archie Miller basketball team. And we'll see what that means.
Yeah, because this is not his guys thing is out the window for me. There are just a couple basic requirements. Shoot the ball, dribble the ball, pass the ball, defend the ball. It's you just have to do those simple things, and I don't care who the coach is and who the player is. If you can't get on that same page, I don't know whose page you're going to be able to be on any court. I mean, those are basic fundamentals, and if Indiana can do those things – at a better rate than their opponents, they're going to do fine. But they've got to shoot the ball is the one important equation in that those four things that I just gave that they haven't done well under Archie. And I'm not blaming Archie but they have not shot the ball well. And that's been the reason they lose games. Basically, if you can't shoot or score, you're not going to win.
Yeah, and he's not afraid to admit that. I mean, I think in one of the availabilities here over the last couple of weeks, he talked about that. You know, you don't shoot the ball well, you're not going to win many games. And then you take those Michigan State games last year where they did knock down a bunch of shots, and lo and behold, they're knocking off a top five ranked team. So I agree to a large extent that, you know, it's not rocket science here. You knock down shots, you're going to win games. I guess the question is, you know, do they have a better shooting team this year? I don't think, you know, looking at up and down the roster, I don't think that's glaringly obvious that's going to be the case. Well, I think it's going to have to be a team effort.
Yeah, that's going to be something that's changed from last year. That Devontae being the only one that did shoot over 40% from behind the arc, hopefully he gets better. Al Durham has to get better. Rob Fennessy has got to get better. Rob Fennessy's got to score more from the point. He does a great job running that point, but this is not a team that can lay off without having that star, without having that score. This is not a team that can lay off the point guard and have basically go 4-on-5 against guys scoring wise. Rob Fennessy's got to score the basketball this season.
Yeah, I agree with that 100%. I think a lot of people have to score the ball more, but he's probably the the top of that list. I mean, he is a natural gifted scorer. I think his percentages really dropped off the cliff last year after he suffered that concussion. He's off to a better pace when you consider that he was a true freshman before that injury happened. And I think he recognizes that. Archie's talked about that. You know, he's not going to be a 15, 20 point per game guy, but if he's in the 10 to 15 range somewhere in there, and he's, you know, breaking down defenses by being a threat both off the dribble and from 3-point range, I think that's what needs to happen this year.
And we don't know how Joey Brunk is really going to be. We don't know how Trace Jackson's really going to be. We don't know how Jerome Hunter is really going to be. Those are three X factors. Joey Brunk could be an X factor here. He was just a sophomore when he played last. So he's growing. He's getting better. Hopefully he's gotten better in the offseason. Trace Jackson Davis, no doubt to me, is going to be one hellacious player a year from now. And I'm not saying he's not going to be very helpful this season. He certainly is. But I'm just saying you can tell this dude's going to be good, man. He's just got the talent. He's got all the stock that you need. He's got the athletic ability. He's got the head on his shoulders. He's got the want to, the drive. He's got those things that we haven't seen that have been missing from this team.
Yeah, I agree completely. I mean, he's got all the things you just described. And, you know, the question for him in year one is going to be, you know, how he fits into a high major program. You know, is he a center because he's not, you know, fully developed yet to extend his game out to the perimeter? And
can I get an amen as the brother, a center? Man, he's done all no problems. That's a joke. It's not like you said center.
Yeah, and I mean that to me is probably the most interesting thing about this team going into the year. When you think about playing time, is, you know, you got Jackson Davis, Brunk, and Deron Davis. You know, three guys that I would say right now, based on what I've seen and know about them, are centers for college basketball. That they just haven't shown me the ability to go out onto the perimeter and knock down shots or handle the basketball in a way that's going to make an impact. And I'm not sure I'm comfortable with any of them defending out on the perimeter either. Trace Jackson's probably the best equipped to do that because he's a little bit better athlete than the other two, or significantly better athlete than the other two. But when you're guarding a guy that, you know, is a stretch four that can really move off the dribble, I think all those guys are going to be challenged to do that. And so, you know, unless one of them surprises us, who's going to get all those minutes and who's going to get left out? I think that's going to be an interesting dynamic. I think it's going to be matchup by matchup in terms of whether or not you can have two of those guys on the floor at the same time. Ideally you'd want to, because I think they're some of your better players and guys that can impact the game, but it's got to be a good fit or you're going to get beat on the other end of the floor.
Back to football this Saturday, the Hoosiers taking on Rutgers, and this should be like a JV game for Indiana. It's just another practice week, to be honest with you, which is great. They've had 2 weeks off the heel and to practice, and this is basically going to be a practice game before they go off to Maryland. In my opinion, Rutgers is just that bad. You've got your coach is fired, your offensive coordinator is fired. You obviously suck because your coach got fired. So, I mean, this should be another easy week for Indiana to roll on.
Yeah, you would certainly like to think that, and it, you know, I certainly expect that to be the case. It is still a Big Ten game, but Indiana has been pretty much able to control this matchup the last few years. It got a little interesting at the tail end last year, but playing at home this weekend, it's homecoming. I think Indiana knows that this is a game they absolutely cannot afford to lose. You mentioned all the changes going on at Rutgers. I mean, there's no reason that Indiana doesn't control this game in a way that they did against UConn a few weeks ago. I mean, to me, it's that kind of game, that kind of opponent. Rutgers might be a little bit better, but you know, Indiana's got to be fully confident, and they're going into it with a confident quarterback, in my opinion, who looked fantastic against Michigan State. Even had the national analyst, I don't know if people picked up on it, but Kirk Herbstreit during the Michigan State-Ohio State game gave a little bit of a plug to Penix and the IU receivers and how good they looked in that Michigan State game. I mean, I think, you know, I think this is a game that they've got to win to get to the fourth win. And then, you know, you mentioned Maryland. There's other games out there like, you know, Northwestern, Purdue, that, you know, those will be the kind of games that are going to really make or break the season.
Absolutely. Mike Schumann from the Daily Hoosier. Thanks, man. We look forward to doing it again next week, and we'll see you on Saturday.
All right, Jim. Have a great one.
You bet. There's Mike Schumann from the Daily Hoosier. It's going to wrap it up for us this hour. We'll be back with more Indiana Sports Beat Radio from the Golf Club at Eagles Point Studios right after this.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just 6909 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the Golf Club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
This is AJ Moyer.
This is Dan Dockett.
Hey, this is Michael Lewis, former Indiana basketball player.
This is Indiana football coach Tom Allen.
This is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat. You can always like and follow us on Facebook. Always follow the show rebroadcast on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spotify. TheDailyHoosier.com is a great place to sign up for each and every day. Or, of course, on 97.7 The Ref in Evansville.
For the best recycling and waste removal service, turn to the area's leader, Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling, a homegrown company serving southern Indiana since 1995. Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling serves Floyd, Clark, Harrison, and Washington County for excellent service and peace of mind. Call Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling today at 812-944-5642. That's 812-944-5642. Keep life sweet with Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling.
I'm Rain Shaddy, and I'm a Hoosier. As a toddler, you could always find me running around in a cream and crimson onesie and a red IU hat reminiscent of those worn during the world-famous William Tell timeout, shouting, "Go Hoosiers!" Like many other alum, I chose to make Bloomington my home. As a civic and alumni leader, I have become very knowledgeable about our community and would love to share my insights with you as your realtor. Find me on Facebook or call or text me, Ryan Shaddy, with FC Tucker Bloomington Realtors at 765-623-9093.
Hey, this is Jordan Halls, former Indiana Hoosier. Keep up with Indiana sports on Indiana Sports Beat.
Radio, of course, coming to you from the Golf Club Eagle Point Studios here on this Monday, October 7th. Just finished up with Mike Schumann, had Don Fisher on before that. Heard from Calbert Chaney and Race Thompson. Tomorrow we're going to hear from Jerome Hunter. As we spoke to him after Hoosier Hysteria, we'll have that complete interview tomorrow. The Hoosiers took part in Hoosier Hysteria over the weekend Saturday. First glimpse of the men's basketball program, women's too. Got to see Jerome Hunter on the floor. It was good to see him moving around. He looked good. It'd be interesting to see how quickly he can get into becoming a factor for that team. Indiana football, of course, was off with a bye this week as this week they head in to a noon contest with Rutgers, which is like playing I don't know who. There's no way to sugarcoat this. This should be a blowout of epic proportions for Indiana. You've had 2 weeks off to practice. You're facing a team who just fired its head coach, its offensive coordinator, who's just not very good, and you're at home. Gee whiz, I can't think of a better scenario for a big win. But a week of additional practice for Indiana is obviously their schedule, to me, gets perfectly more difficult. And by that, what I mean is you had 2 weeks off of rest. Then you go into an easy little game with Rutgers. Then you got to travel on the road, a little tougher test. But you're going to Maryland, but it's not like you're going to Nebraska, which you do the following week, which that makes it a little more difficult. Then you come back and play Northwestern at home. I think Indiana can win all four of those games. Then they have to go on the road to Penn State before coming back to play Michigan. And I think they can win that game. And then they go on the road to play Purdue. I literally think it's crazy talk, but this team could literally, they currently have 3 wins. Nine wins is not out of the question for this football team. I'm just looking at the schedule. They're 3-2 right now. You got Rutgers and Maryland coming up. I'll be honest with you. Obviously, they should win the Rutgers game, but even on the road at Maryland, they lose that game. That's an upset. You cannot lose to a Maryland team. I don't care where you're playing them. So that would give them 5 wins as they head off to play Nebraska and Lincoln. Yes, that is an uber tough environment. But guess what? I think Indiana's got a better team. I think they can win that game. That would make them bowl eligible already. That would give them 6 wins there. You got to go to Penn State. That's a rough place to go, period. Penn State is really good. I'm going to put an L in that category. But they come back home to play against Michigan. That's a winnable game, although Michigan's defense looked extremely good over the weekend. They held Iowa to 3 points. And then Indiana has to travel to Purdue. If they don't win 8 games, I think it's going to be extraordinarily disappointing for this team. Extraordinarily. That allows them losing to Michigan and Penn State. But they have to win the rest. There's no reason to not win every one of those other games. None. Hopefully they can get that done. We'll certainly find out. The game is Saturday's noon. I'm sure that's on BTN. I don't have that in front of me. A noon contest for Indiana, which is also homecoming. So if you're coming up for that, hopefully the weather, we got this fall weather in now. It gives you time to hit up the local establishments in Bloomington, have a good time. As we're getting closer and closer to basketball season. That game is on BTN at noon. So Indiana on television once again. Not going to be long before they're playing some feature games. You go to Nebraska and you go to Nebraska and beat Nebraska. I promise you that Penn State game the next week is going to be on a much higher platform. That Michigan game, much higher platform. You start winning games, you catch people's attention. And I think Indiana caught a lot of people's attention last week in East Lansing. I'm looking forward to seeing what they can do this week. But like I said, it's not going to be a very stiff test. Absolutely. There is no way this game will be anything other than a blowout. You want to watch good blowout football? Come check out Indiana Hoosiers this Saturday as they blow out Rutgers. I'm just saying. Because if you don't do that, that's like losing. Almost. Not quite. Nothing's as bad as losing. But you've got to handle a team like this. You've got to show that, yeah, we can handle the big boys because we just destroy the teams that we're supposed to. You know, that's what the Penn States and those teams do. They handle the teams they're supposed to handle and play with the teams they're supposed to play with. But if you noticed, a very good Michigan State team that Indiana could have beaten, they suffered a fate against Ohio State that most have. May not have been quite as bad, but you saw a Michigan State team turn the ball over a little bit, and Ohio State just jumps on them. How about the Colts? Haven't talked enough about that, man. I know we don't do a lot of Colts here, but gee whiz. You go into Kansas City and you beat Patrick Mahomes and the Chiefs on the road? Woo! You hold them to 13 points? That's what that is like the most prolific offense in the NFL. They held them to 13. What a job defensively the Colts did. And how about Jacoby Brissett? Everybody thought the season was lost. Have they gotten better? Is it better by attrition? Addition by attrition? Addition by subtraction? Jake's shaking his head. No, you don't think so?
No, I mean, Jacoby Brissett, I like Jacoby Brissett a lot, but he didn't win the game for him last night.
No, he did not, but he obviously did good enough. He didn't make the mistakes to cost him the game.
No, he didn't. I mean, the game was won by the offensive line and Marlon Mack. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, even the defense. The defense stepped up when they had to, but the time of possession, especially in the second half, was like 6-1 Colts.
Yeah, they kept the ball out of Patrick Mahomes' hand. That's one way to beat him. Because I can tell, oh, man, when you watch Patrick Mahomes, and I'm not cracking on Jacoby Brissett, but my gosh, you watch Patrick Mahomes, and he's running around making these crazy throws across his body, throwing these dead spirals on a frozen rope to guys across his body. It was nuts. And then you watch Jacoby Brissett. He looks like me running around out there, lumbering around. It's like, woo, there's a big difference in speed right there. Now, Patrick Mahomes won't be able to do that his entire career, but he can do it right now. He can certainly do it right now. Wow, what a great performance by them. Congratulations. But we got more coming up here. We have a reboot from Todd Leary up next. Stay tuned. We got more Indiana Sports Beat Radio coming to you from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios here on this Monday, October 7th. Back with more right after this. I have a tendency to wear my mind on my sleeve. I have a history of taking off my shirt. It's been 1 week since you looked at me.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the Golf Club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100, the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
This is AJ Moyer.
This is Dan Dockett.
Hey, this is Michael Lewis, former Indiana basketball player.
This is Indiana football coach Tom Allen.
This is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat. You can always like and follow us on Facebook. Always follow the show rebroadcast on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spotify. TheDailyHoosier.com is a great place to sign up for each and every day. Or, of course, on 97.7 The Ref in Evansville.
For the best recycling and waste removal service, turn to the area's leader, Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling, a homegrown company serving Southern Indiana since 1995. Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling serves Floyd, Clark, Harrison, and Washington counties for excellent service and peace of mind. Call Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling today at 812-944-5642. That's 812-944-5642. Keep life sweet with Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling.
I'm Rain Shaddy, and I'm a Hoosier. As a toddler, you could always find me running around in a cream and crimson onesie and a red IU hat reminiscent of those worn during the world-famous William Tell timeout, shouting, "Go Hoosiers!" Like many other alum, I chose to make Bloomington my home. As a civic and alumni leader, I have become very knowledgeable about our community and would love to share my insights with you as your realtor. Find me on Facebook or call or text me, Ryan Shaddy, with FC Tucker Bloomington Realtors at 765-623-9093.
You're on the line with Jamal Meeks, former Indiana Hoosier, number 23, 1992. And I'm on the beat with Jim Cole.
Today's guest is brought to you by Reynolds Family Dentistry of Sellersburg. You need a $1 million smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you'll get with Reynolds Family Dentistry.
Back to Indiana Sports Beat Radio. Let's go live now to the top, Father Todd Leary. How's that for intro music, man?
What, did I go to a 1970s sitcom music? What is that?
Yeah, what is that, Jake? That's, I got to give all the credit to Jake. He pulls that stuff out. What was that, man? What was that, Jake? He's not listening to me.
It was like Mark and Mindy or something.
Talking with Todd.
That's Talking with Todd. Oh, that's the new series, okay. Talking with Todd.
All right, cool.
Oh man, what's up, Todd Leary? How are you, brother?
I need to start being involved in the brain trust when you guys put these stuff together.
That's what happens when you show up once a week. You have very little input. How are things going with Todd Leary?
Things are going good. Appreciate it. It's a good week. Another good week. Beautiful weather all week. Man, it was frosty this morning waking up, so that actually feels pretty good outside.
Yeah, I noticed that, man. It was like a little chilly, but that's what you want for the fall weather. It's football season, but actually the news this week is about basketball. Of course, Indiana, I was up in Chicago on Wednesday for the Big Ten basketball media day up there, and then of course tomorrow Hoosier Hysteria is going on. Are you making it up for Hoosier Hysteria?
I will not be making it up for Hoosier Hysteria, unfortunately.
So you're not in the dunk
contest. I'm disappointed because I know Calvert Cheney and his family is going to be there, and so I am disappointed I don't get to go, but I know it'll be a good time.
I thought you may be entering the dunk contest.
Did they have a 7-foot goal?
They would need one for me, that's for daggone sure now.
I'm telling you what, I've got some mean dunks on a 7-foot goal.
Hey man, there's a lot of talk of this fair pay for play, the law that just went in. It was signed into a law by the California governor, but it doesn't go into effect till 2023. But it spurred a lot of other states. They're doing the same thing, and the NCAA is behind. They have nothing in place, but they are disagreeing with it. To say, you know, you can't do that because if you want to be a pro, go be a pro. So there's arguments to both sides. And I definitely see both sides. And because of that, the more I read about it, I'm like, okay, I don't know where to be here because I can see how it would be fair to the players, but also at the same time, I see a whole lot of problems that can come with that. Where are you on all this?
Yeah, you know, I don't know enough details about it. Like, I don't know, like, the amount of money they're talking about, and I don't know
you know, I just don't know enough details to say whether I'm really for or against it. Here's kind of what I would be for in that is, I know back when I played, and I think they've changed this rule, but way back in the 90s, as an athlete, you were not allowed to work. And I think that was kind of their way of keeping track so that people didn't have, you know, BS jobs where they were just getting paid by people to not even show up. But not being allowed to work was a difficult situation because not everybody comes in, even though, you know, your school and stuff is paid for in a scholarship. There's still a lot of other stuff that goes on. And there's a lot of kids that go to school that even still need to help their families out. And to restrict them from being able to work and the amount of hours that they can work and the amount of pay that they can get and things like that is, I don't really see how that's fair. And I don't see how they are just in doing so. But on the flip side of it, I also see you're opening up, you're opening up for just anarchy as far as it coming to, you know, you'll have guys at Kentucky that'll be making $200,000 a year, you know, watering lawns again. And so I don't know. I can't really say. I think if you sat down in a room and you knew all the details, and I think you could come up with something that was fair. And I think if they did that and then set the penalties so insanely strict that if you broke those rules or went above those rules or paid above them or did whatever, like it would be a serious impact on your entire program if that happened. You know, I'm sure there's a way I could figure out to be for it. If you don't have super strict restrictions on it, then I think it just could just get crazy out of control.
Yeah, that's my fear. As I look at a school like Oregon, who is out where Nike is located, you see them with all the crazy uniforms all the time because Nike just covers them up. Well, what prevents an Oregon from having Nike set up prearranged endorsement deals with any player they sign? Well, who the hell wouldn't want to go to Oregon?
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's supposed to be one of those things where, you know, you're not allowed to have any contact with, you know, with agents and with things like that. I think that would fall into that category of, you know, we weren't even allowed to have discussions with anyone who was an agent or an attorney that worked in a group that had agents in it or anything like that. I mean, they were pretty darn strict about that stuff and who you could even have conversations and back and forth with. So, you know, I don't know. I see the NCAA's point in that it, you know, it opens up the possibility of some big time cheating and trouble. But you also will not hear me agree with the NCAA very often because some of the rules and stuff that they have in place are just kind of silly and ridiculous. And, no. You know, the IHSAA, they're kind of like the IHSAA of college basketball. I mean, some of their rules are just dumb and stupid and they don't make any sense.
Absolutely. I agree wholeheartedly. Saw Bob Knight was out on his tour, I guess you'd call it. He was at Marion College. I did not know Steve Downing was at Marion College now. Did you?
Yeah, I did know that actually. I've kind of kept track of Marion quite a bit because Coach Hetty, the former coach from Carmel High School where my kids were at, went to Marion and I've always kind of liked, you know, him and what he's done. His dad was the coach back at Carmel when I played against Carmel in high school. So I just kind of always followed them and I like watching them and their program. And then they've got some kids on that team that are from Carmel and a couple of kids that I coached in AAU. So I followed them a little bit and I was aware that Downing was there. I mean, Steve Downing is as quality a human as you could possibly run into. So that's just one of those guys you root for and hope is successful in everything he does, which he always is.
Yeah, I just happened to see that Knight was up there. They had a picture with, and Scott May was with him as well. Now, I did know a former teammate of yours is the athletics director at Bradley, Chris Reynolds.
Yep. I mean, I'm telling you, there are some guys who are actually successful and smart people other than just being good basketball players. I know that shocks you, but
what happened
some
to
of
you?
Us aren't the dumbest humans in the world.
What happened to Todd Leary?
Yeah, he is one of the dumbest humans in the world. I'm the one that you guys always make fun of. So yes, I
never. My favorite. No, but yeah, it's cool. It sucks that you won't be able to go. Back when you were playing, I can't remember Did they have a Midnight Madness type of thing going on? I cannot remember.
Yeah, you know, it was really just kind of starting to be big. And I think, I want to say Kentucky was big at it. I think they started having kind of a big one. But we had, so we kind of had a fake Midnight Madness when we would have, coach would have us come out and basically scrimmage and just do some little, you know, BS drills and some of that stuff. What people don't really get is, like, it wasn't exciting and fun for us. It wasn't like some big spectacle like it is now where they're broadcasting them on ESPN and that thing. So we did a couple of little things. You know, we would do a few little drills or whatever, and then maybe scrimmage for, like, you know, 20 minutes or something like that. And it seemed like, you know, that was really all it is. What everybody didn't really realize is that, you know, and we'd get, you know, 10,000 to 12,000 people in the stands. Students would be there crazy. And that part of it made it a lot of fun. But then usually 8 o'clock the next morning, we were having a real practice. And so that midnight practice wasn't near as exciting for us as it was for the fans, because about 8 hours later, we were getting drilled.
Well, at least now they get to do it at 4:30 in the afternoon. They don't have to do it at midnight.
Yep. Yep. It's totally changed. You know, that's just part of the times and the way it is. I like how they do it now. It gives, you know, it's kind of a fun event to get things kicked off and started. It's unfortunate for us. It wasn't fun. It was, I would have loved to have had it more interaction with the fans and some of that stuff. But you and I both know that just wasn't Coach's MO, and he didn't really care a whole lot about that. So
yeah, that's a different
it was
deal.
Kind of a business as usual. And then a couple hours later, we got to business, got to real work.
Yeah. What do you think his opinion on that fair pay to play act is? I'm pretty sure we can all guess that.
You know, what's funny about him is when you think that, you know, what his opinion is going to be, it's almost always exactly the opposite. So it'd be hard to guess what he really would think of that. And, you know, the real interesting part would have been, you know, how he felt about it back when he was coaching, you know, back in the 70s and 80s. I could see him. I mean, my initial reaction would be, yeah, he would hate it and think it was stupid, except for, you know, he definitely dealt with, we had people that came to school that, you know, their families needed help and needed money and needed things like that. And it was a need. It wasn't being greedy or anything like that. So I can see where he might not have had near as negative a thought on it as what we would just initially guess he would.
Yeah, I mean, people, you go way back, people like Larry Bird is a perfect example, who came to Bloomington near penniless and left because he was overwhelmed by the quote-unquote size of Bloomington, which is not a very big city, but it is when you compare it to French Lick. But, there are tons of kids who don't have the same situation coming in. I mean, they got parents who can't afford to come watch them play. And that's something the NCAA needs to look at during the tournament. When you send somebody out to California to play and they're from Florida, how are their parents supposed to get out there and follow their kids?
Yeah, it's there's some really difficult issues when you get to that. That's why, I mean, I think if you really, you got a good group and representative of people that would come from the, you know, from the NCAA and from the athletic director standpoint and from coaches standpoint, and even get some, you know, former player parent representatives to be a part of it, because what it's like for a kid to go off to school and go off to college. There are a lot more expenses that are involved other than just your actual tuition and your books and, you know, your housing and that stuff. And believe me, I don't want to sound like I'm not grateful. To finish school with a degree and not have student loans I will forever be grateful for that. But I was fortunate to where, you know, my family could help me out with, you know, with stuff for your apartment and stuff for food, you know, have food and groceries and things like that. And I was very fortunate with that. And there are just a lot of kids that are not in that case. And when you don't allow them, or you restrict what they're allowed to do working wise to make some extra money, I think that you're also, you've got to give some consideration to paying them a little bit of money to cover some of those other things if you're going to restrict what they're allowed to do working wise.
Yeah, that's a great point. What do you think the students who leave school with $150,000, $200,000 in student loans are thinking about, players that think that they're not getting enough.
And believe me, I understand that perspective too. I mean, all of my kids will leave school with student loans. So believe me, I understand that side of it. And I get where people are saying you are getting, you know, you're getting all of that for free. And that is factual. So I'm not sitting here saying yes, that every kid should also get $100,000 a year.
It's a tough situation. There's no doubt. It's just like I said, I don't know where I stand now. I thought I used to, but now I'm like, man, I get there's arguments for both sides, and it's a tough deal. And I hope they get it worked out right, because otherwise, I don't want to see it affect college athletics. Because to me, there's nothing better than college basketball, college football. I just love college athletics. It's my favorite.
Yep, me too. And it's, you know, it's crazy and it's awesomely crazy that it has remained as entertaining and great and awesome as it has, given the fact that the NCAA has been involved and in charge of it for so long, because it does not seem like very many decisions they make are right.
Nope, sure not. We're heading into Hoosier Hysteria on Saturday, like I said. That means the start of basketball season, man, is not far away. I can't believe it that we're already here, but we are. Most of the national prognosticators, looking kindly on Indiana, they've all placed them in like finishing 10th or worst in the Big Ten, which is pretty bad, to be honest with you. But what are your thoughts going into this season? This is year three for Archie. Number one, he's got to produce. I think that he does not make the tournament this year, he is definitely in trouble with his job.
I think that the expectation from the athletic department and from the coaching staff and in himself is definitely for them to make the tournament. And, I think his goals are probably much higher than that. And so I don't know. Like, I still don't say that his job would be in jeopardy. I super am on the other end of that, and I don't want to start over. And I think, I think if you looked at him from a 10-year perspective and just said, hey, it's your job for 10 years, you know, make it, figure out a way to make it happen. And that to me is more of a timeline. I think you can, and now 10 years is a long time. I mean, maybe 6, 7, 8 years or something like that. But I don't see 3 years or 4 years as, I don't see that as a great judgment of how good he can end up being. And I think they're moving in the right direction. I want to see, you know, you and I talked about this before. I want to see some guys play above their expectations. I want to see Indiana needs some players that end up being the Victor Oladipos and, you know, the Calvert Chaneys. And I don't just mean that good, but those guys didn't have super high expectations when they came in and ended up being, you know, a couple of the best players that have ever walked into that university. So we're ready for some more of those, you know, some Yogi Ferrells, some guys where they're good. You expect them to be good and solid, and they're even outstanding and so much better than what anyone thought they would be. And Indiana needs one or two of those guys every year. I mean, I think Romeo did a good job. I think he did a fantastic job. I think the expectations were extremely unrealistic for what he was going to be able to do in 1 year. And so, you know, I think they need the Romeos every year. I think they need some guys that also fill out that roster and that starting lineup and that 7-man rotation that are role players and that get the rebounds and that get the assists and that play defense and do all that stuff. So, you know how I am on the recruiting. I love one or two, four or five star guys. And I love a couple of 2 and 3 star guys who are super excited to be there and want to just work their butt off and play as hard as they can.
You're the perfect good cop to my bad cop.
Well, I don't appreciate you using the word cop involved in me in anything. Totally kidding. I love all law enforcement.
Absolutely. Well, the season's upon us, so next time we speak, we'll be talking about the post-Hoosier Hysteria comings and goings, which won't be much. It's just mostly a parade for the fans for them to get out. And to not forget to bring canned goods to the Simon Scott Assembly Hall. But, brother, we could go. I could go on all day with you, but unfortunately, I know you got to get to work, so I'll let you get back to it.
I'm sitting in the parking lot now, so I will. I appreciate you letting me go a little bit early, and I'll look forward to talking to you next week.
Absolutely. Todd Lehrer, the Todd Father, with us as always. Thank you, sir. Hope you have a great weekend.
You too. See you, brother.
Thank you very much. Todd Lehrer, our good friend, joining us here. Hey, coming up more on Indiana Sports Beat Radio, Tom Brew is going to join us next. We've got a lot more in addition to that. We're going to hear from Archie Miller as well as we continue when we sat down with him a few days ago in Chicago at the Big Ten Basketball Media Day. Also, Steve Aird, Indiana's volleyball coach, is going to join us in the next hour as well. So stay tuned. We got lots more coming up here on Indiana Sports Beat Radio. We're back with more right after this.
So baby, let's sell your diamond ring, buy some boots and faded jeans and go.
Hello, everybody. Jim Coyle from Indiana Sports Beat. When I'm not covering the Hoosiers, you can find me at Bubba's 33 in Clarksville, located on the northeast corner of I-65 at Veterans Parkway. Bubba's 33 has hand-tossed pizzas, bold burgers, and ice-cold beer from a select list of local craft brewers. An incredible food selection, all made fresh daily. Whether you're meeting the team for that post-win meal in the family dining area or meeting friends for happy hour to watch the game on one of Bubba's 50 TVs, Bubba's 33 in Clarksville. Pizza, burgers, beer.
We all want a winning smile for those championship photos, and that's exactly what you will get at Reynolds Family Dentistry in Sellersburg. Reynolds Family Dentistry has been serving the dental needs of Hoosier families for over 30 years. Let Drs. Roger and Jay Reynolds take care of your family. Just off of I-65 at 809 South Indiana Avenue in Sellersburg. Call 812-246-3368. That's Reynolds Family Dentistry, 812-246-3368.
Now that warm weather has arrived, it's time to hit the links, and there's no better place than the Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington. Voted best golf course by the readers of the Bloomington Herald Times, the Golf Club at Eagle Point is under new ownership, has new fairways and bunkers, and it's open to the public. When the round's over, there's cold beer and a full menu at the Eagle Point Pub and Bistro. Call 812-824-1100 to make a tee time. That's 812-824-1100. The Golf Club at Eagle Point in Bloomington.
This is A.J. Moyer.
This is Dan Dockett.
Hey, this is Michael Lewis, former Indiana basketball player.
This is Indiana football coach Tom Allen.
This is Jim Coyle with Indiana Sports Beat. You can always like and follow us on Facebook. Always follow the show rebroadcast on iTunes, Google Play, iHeartRadio, Spotify. TheDailyHoosier.com is a great place to sign up for each and every day. Or, of course, on 97.7 The Ref in Evansville.
For the best recycling and waste removal service, turn to the area's leader, Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling, a homegrown company serving southern Indiana since 1995. Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling serves Floyd, Clark, Harrison, and Washington counties for excellent service and peace of mind. Call Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling today at 812-944-5642. That's 812-944-5642. Keep life sweet with Sweetland Waste Removal and Recycling.
I'm Rain Shatty, and I'm a Hoosier. As a toddler, you could always find me running around in a cream and crimson onesie and a red IU hat reminiscent of those worn during the world-famous William Tell timeout, shouting, "Go Hoosiers!" Like many other alum, I chose to make Bloomington my home. As a civic and alumni leader, I have become very knowledgeable about our community and would love to share my insights with you as your realtor. Find me on Facebook or call or text me, Ryan Shatty, with FC Tucker Bloomington Realtors at 765-623-9093.
Welcome back to Indiana Sports Beat Radio, coming to you, of course, from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios in Bloomington. We had the opportunity to sit down with Archie Miller Wednesday at up in Chicago, Rosemont, actually, outside of Chicago. Big Ten Basketball Media Day is going on. Got to talk to Tom Izzo, Matt Painter. Fran McCaffrey sat in with us on the show. Got to talk to a lot of guys, but we sat down with Archie for almost 40 minutes. The absolute most interaction we'll get with him all season. This is the funny thing is I'll see him 10 minutes at a time from now on as the season goes out. But we played the first half of that for you yesterday. Then we got the back half of that. Let's hear what Archie had to say.
really thoughts on Justin Smith, especially if he's developed some skills to move out a little bit on perimeter more for you this year?
You know, Justin's a guy who's played in every game as a college player, so he has experience under his belt. What we need from Justin, you know, to be honest with you, is leadership. Justin's got to be a guy that's used all that experience to help his teammates, you know, expressing himself more in form of leadership and togetherness and team. That's a big thing for him. He is so talented and so gifted that on any given night he could do something that is a Sports Center highlight. You know, what we need from him is more of that blue-collar approach. You know, he's a defender. I think he can be as good as anybody in our league defending multiple positions. You know, offensively, he's got to play to his strengths. He's got to get out in transition, which means he's got to run hard. He's got to attack the glass, which when he does, it really impacts the game. And in some of our big, big wins, he's been a big, big part of what we're doing. You know, so I think early on, understanding how important a role he plays, you know, he's got to accept that and got to try to be who he is. You know, and at the end of the day, you know, play to win. Those are big things for him.
Does it still give him a green light to shoot? You still give Justin Smith a green light to shoot?
All of our players have a green light to what they earn. You know, Justin's a guy that's going to have to find a way to keep the team, you know, the defense honest. You know, but with where we're playing, I think he's going to move all around. You know, putting him in a position to be successful is important.
He seems like a really intellectual guy. Does he overthink it too much? He said the other day that he's too hard on himself at times. I can see that visibly on the court sometimes. Is that something he needs to work on?
Yeah, I don't know how you work on it. I think you go through it. You are who you are. You're wired how you're wired. And I think you can't allow things as an older player to bother you the way younger players view things. So much one mistake, one missed shot, one bad play can really steamroll young guys. It's just like one loss could steamroll one young guy. When you've been through it, you hope that it's always you're focusing on the next play, winning, and all those things. And I think that's where Justin needs to focus most of his effort level because, as I've said, he's an unbelievable niche in terms of how we play and what he can do to impact the team on both ends. And if Justin's defending the other team's most versatile player, if he's doing a great job there, if he's hammering the offensive glass, if he's finishing in transition, if he's a live body getting to the foul line, those are great things to have, and I think that's what he's got to value. Sometimes so much of what you value is what you think you should be valuing, and at the end of the day, that impedes winning. So when he impacts winning and he sees how that happens, that's what he's got to be consumed with.
Last year's team was a lot younger than this year's team for the most part. Have you changed how you maybe approach coaching the team at all with the added experience with like two true freshmen this year?
It's definitely a newer team. Last year having five true freshmen on the grind, two sophomores that, you know, really played a ton, and a new guy in Fitzner at the time. We had a lot of new bodies. But I thought that team competed hard at times and showed. What we lacked was maturity. What we lacked where it was mental toughness, going through adversity, things like that that just, you know, really hurt you. And it really hurts your ability to keep progressing. Hopefully the returners all understand it. But our new guys understand and coming in, that's a big part of what you're getting ready to deal with. All the fun and games and all the glamour, social media, you name it, all the good things that come along with being an Indiana player. There's a responsibility to understand that's not what it's about. And I think having a keen sense early on that we're going to deal with adversity, we're going to go with growing pains, those are things that are talked about a lot more with this group. But also coaching them hard. This team's got to be prepared hard. They've got to be coached hard. They've got to be hard on themselves. They have to be competitive with one another, because for us to be at our best on a given night, we should be sitting there talking about different people. We should be talking about different people having different impacts on the game and roles, because like I said, got a lot of guys in my opinion I think that can get on the floor and play, so that's a good thing.
Coach McCaffrey mentioned that the 3-point distance might help teams to play zone and pack line. Play pack line. Any thoughts on whether that might help you this long 3-point line defensively?
Yeah, I mean, when we're good on defense and a 3-point shot, with a 3-point field goal percentage defense is good, you're taking tough challenge shots or end of the clock threes because you're making a team work, because you're not giving them anything easy in transition, or you're not giving them easy early opportunity. So if you work later in the clock, typically that shot's a little harder. But, you know, I think, you know, teams in general will have a philosophy. I think teams that work deeper into the clock that make teams shoot challenge threes, maybe it has an impact on it. we'll see. You know, I know they moved the line back a few years ago, and it's kind of like it never was moved back. So
yeah.
I think kids are growing up nowadays. Last 5, 6, 7 years, a three-point shot's like a layup. They start shooting that before they do anything else. So, you know, to me, the three-point line, you know, plays a big role, you know. But to me, you know, being able to defend it's a huge thing.
Since you guys have experimented a bit with Al as the primary ball handler, how does that kind of affect your half-court offense when you compare Al running that to Devontae or even Robbie?
Al's going to play a lot more point this year. I think it's important that he does. He, to me, can push the ball, and he has good tempo. But he looks at me when we talk about it. He knows what's going on. He knows what I'm looking for. And he can really, to me, continue to help our pace. You know, with Devontae, he's a guy that uses a lot of dribbles sometimes. And in cases, sometimes he's thinking about scoring. I think maybe Al, as a facilitator and as a guy that continues our pace, can allow Devontae off the ball a little bit more. So I see all three guys playing at the point. I see, you know, me early on here really experimenting with Devontae off the ball as much as it is early in the offense as possible. That gives him a chance to get down the floor. But Al will play off the ball as well. We have a good three-ring kind of circus there a little bit with those three guys. And, you know, Rob, obviously, primary ball handler in his own right, does a good job running our offense.
Are you comfortable with just having four scholarship guards?
I don't think you're ever comfortable, but, you know, I think at the end of the day, those guys finding a way, playing a bulk of the minutes, will develop great chemistry. They'll have confidence because they know that they're going to contribute and play. And to me, that's as much as anything in this day and age, is these guys knowing and understanding their role and playing and keeping a good camaraderie about them. But those four guys will play a role. And obviously Justin, Jerome, and Demisi filling in on the perimeter a little bit more because we have such a stable, knock on wood, we have a stable of bigs that got to play.
Armand, I guess you got your Ironman Award.
Yeah.
Confidence builder, you think, for him? What's he done to kind of get
there? He's impressive, man. He's an impressive kid, you know, on and off the floor. He's a great teammate. Early on, it's very, very evident how likable of a player he's going to be at Indiana. He's not mean enough. He's not tough enough right now. He doesn't talk enough. You know, that's my thing to him. But to go through a fall preseason and to be able to win that award, and to me, you could have had some arguments on who the second guy was, but as a true freshman, to participate 100% in everything that we've done, to be the leader in the two main conditioning elements of our fall camp, whether that's non-weight bearing on machines or whether that's running, him to be there, it's very unique to have a true freshman to be able to be your top guy. So to come in the door and find a way to make his mark early, he made his mark. You know, he really did. He set the tone for how he works, the standard that he has for himself. There was no days off, and that's a great thing as a young player. Very few young guys come in and don't struggle early with something or don't have to learn how to work through it. His work capacity, his work ethic, man, it was impressive. So to me, that's a credit to him. But I think now the next step is, as a player, what he's really got to focus in on is taking that one thing and then learning what you want as a coach to get out of him, which to me is the more of the vocal one. Like he said, I don't even know what you're talking about half the time. How do you want me to talk about it? Just find a way to talk, you know what I mean? Just say something. You know, you can always say something to be better. So it's a great kid.
Numbers based, or was there some subjective? The more that he got, was it all based on
numbers? Numbers based. You know, there's a lot of numbers that go into the times that you run, the averages that you run on a weekly basis, the times that you, for us working on a VersaClimber machine, whether it's two or three times a week, the averages that you hit your mark. To me, he was the top guy in a lot of those challenging areas that, you know, a lot of our guys will tell you is very difficult.
We talked about the importance of the number of guys needing to contribute each night. When you lose so much scoring like you do from last season to this year, have you try and emphasize to guys that, hey, it doesn't need to be me every night getting 20 or something like that?
Move the ball. Move the ball, man. Move the ball. The more you share the ball, the more you move the ball, the more you pass it, the more you work with one another, the more guys are going to contribute. That's just the name of the game. That's how it works. And this team has got to be that type of belief. It's got to be that type of eccentric. You have to have possessions and times where it's 5, 6, 7 passes, 8 passes. And then, you know what, when you're showing film as a team, the credit is given to the pass. The credit is given to the sharing. It's not the score. We need a group that has a team that scores a lot of points, from a lot of different people. And you know what? Maybe that's one guy got four or five one night on the road. That's a big deal in the Big Ten if you can get somebody to come in there, get five or six. At home, maybe it's four guys in double figures. That hasn't happened a ton for us in our tenure. When we've had that, we've won. Maybe it's Devontae and Al having good nights, but maybe it's our front line being able to get to the foul line a ton. A lot of different ways to skin a cat, but this team, ball movement, you know. That's the exciting thing as a staff. It's what you're preaching. It's what you want. It's what everybody hopes that every team is. They move the ball. They share it. They're a team that's fun to watch. That's what we got to be.
Is there a particular reason you think that your past Indiana teams haven't maybe moved the ball as well as you would have liked?
You know, I don't know. I think, you know, each team's built a little bit differently. You know, in some cases, you know, the philosophy and the emphasis of what we were trying to do, you know, at times created great shots. They didn't go in, so you don't see it as much. You know, sometimes the open one's got to go down. You know, and in our last 2 years, open shots has been a big thing where, man, just wish the open ones would go in every once in a while. People would be talking about your assist rate going up, or, you know, your field goal percentage offense. Wow, they're shooting a high percentage. You know, a lot of it is, you know, make the open ones, you know, make your free throws. You know what I mean? We've been a poor free throw shooting team in our last year. We spent a lot of time as a team in the offseason with our free throw approach. And, you know, a guy like Al, you know, in this offseason, he shot 92%. He shot 92% from the line as a guy in this offseason. You know, he should go into the season really feeling good about that. So for us, you know, I don't think we've ever not stressed certain things. I think, you know, we got to get some productivity in certain of those areas. And part of it is, you know, you look at some of our backcourt guys, you know, when they're open, they're hitting them. You know, they're hitting one, two a game. That's not an alarming number in this day and age in college. You know, some guys are making four or five threes a game. We're asking our guys to take open ones and make them. So, you know, high assist team requires guys to make shots. You know, and we got to get some guys to step up and, you know, make the ones that are capable of making.
That was Archie Miller. We had the opportunity to sit down with him, man, for a very long extended time up in Chicago at Big Ten Basketball Media Day. So there's a lot of questions and answers. You heard there's so much to go into. Al Durham playing a lot more point guard this year behind Rob Phinisee as a backup because they have not been able to land one. Hitting shots is going to be key because they have not added shooters. Something else they haven't done well, so they're going to have to start knocking down shots, man. It's going to be a very interesting basketball season. Hey, it's going to wrap it up for us here on this Monday, October 7th, from Indiana Sports Beat Radio at the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studio. It's been another great day, start to the week. Of course, you can't start it any better than you do with Don Fisher, the voice of the Hoosiers, as we did earlier today. Mike Schumann from the Daily Hoosier was on with us. We got to hear from Calvert Chaney, Race Thompson, a little bit of Jerome Hunter. We'll hear more from Jerome Hunter tomorrow. So make sure you join us then, as well as Chronic Hoosier, because it's a Chronic Tuesday. Hey, thanks a lot. Thanks to Jake for keeping us on the track. Until tomorrow, I'm Jim Coyle, and I will see you on the radio.